suffering from arthritis. I had an infection in my left leg, and I still cannot wear my shoes. It doesn't fit the shoes up to now. Anyway, good morning, everyone. I'm very pleased and honored to be invited in this forum. I did not prepare any transparency to be shown, although we can leave some PowerPoint for your consumption. So I just would like to first greet our my seatmates at the table. We have, of course, my Amina here from the Philippine Center for Islam and Democracy. I'm of course closer to Fatima. And of course we have from ECOP, Mr. Moya, our the organizer of all this. We have Toots Albert and Pita Aldaba, Asik Aldaba from DTI, Ms. Basil Layote from the Philippine Business for Education, and to our all our colleagues here and friends from media, allow me to just tackle a few points which may have relevance on our discussion report, Industrial Revolution. And maybe first is my appreciation for the work of PIDS in studies and policy recommendations during the time I was undersecretary, and that was for quite some time. I had always invited the PIDS to partner with us in doing our studies, and I remember the biggest one was our very first national survey on innovation activities among our industries. And I guess that started the interest on studying innovation among enterprises, and it is really very useful in formulating policy. On the part of DOST, we actually need to do a lot of studies that will help us in formulating policies. First of all, for example, we have adopted a number of major policy shifts that I think will not have only an effect on FIR, but on the development of our regions in particular, in response to the president's call for three things that I have repeated in all my, in all audiences. Maybe some of you have heard it already, but one is his desire to reduce inequality. And I think before we, shall we say, go all out on IR, let us see how we can promote this reduction in inequality. Because for all you know, pushing IR may further result in inequality among our enterprises. But of course, these are the things that we have to consider. The second one, which is a, shall we say, a major policy that we have adopted, would be what kind of programs shall we have so that the collaboration between two major stakeholders in research can be stronger. And I'm referring to our industries and to our higher educational institutions. Both of them have interest to do research on the part of industry and business. They want research to come up with innovations or to solve their problems. On the part of the university, there are many reasons why they want to do research. Of course, it's one of their major mandates. And of course, our professors would like to publish. Okay, but I think since the government is putting public resources in research, we would like to get the most benefits out of the investment. And so we would like to have some kind of alignment and synergy between the interest of the industry and the academe or the universities in case came up with a new program wherein if a company will identify a certain research area which can help him in his industry, in his business or enterprise, he can choose a university whom he thinks can help him, and together they can propose to us, and we will give the bulk of the resources to do the research. Then the other thing I think that we have introduced is really on the manner of evaluating the project proposals that come to us. I still have to say that the projects that we have been supporting is very much proposal driven. In other words, the researchers, the institutions which do research, which includes the universities as well as the research arms of our line agencies, and also private foundations that support science and technology, are the proposals come from them. Although we have made it a point that to say that they should take a look at the National Harmonized Research and Development Agenda, which in the first place has a requirement to be approved by NEDA, okay, so that they can see whether their proposals are aligned or not. And in some instances, we tell them what are the some of the priority researchers that we do, and if they can come up, okay, with proposals, maybe we can select the best that will be chosen for implementation. So in our evaluation of these proposals, we have started doing some, I don't know whether it's bean counting or some quantitative methods, not exactly quantitative, but at least some measurable indicators of what we expect from a research project. So we call them the six P's. Of course, in marketing, we have so many P's also. And in doing our proposal evaluation, we evaluate, although a proposal did not have all of these six P's. First of all, what will be your product? Okay. Well, it can come in the form of a product that is marketable, or it can be a technology that has potentials for contributing to economic activity and competitiveness. Number two would be the intellectual property. We call it P because usually when we think of intellectual property, it's the patent that comes in our minds, although there are many other forms of intellectual property like industrial design and utility models. Well, of course, we cannot set aside the desire of our researchers and our academic institutions to publish. And this is also one of the indicators of innovative activity. The indices usually that measure the innovativeness of a particular country includes very much the counting of publications and the counting of intellectual property registrations. And so that would be under publications. We have also P to represent people. You know, when we support a project and a research and development project, we see to it that there are some students who will benefit from it. More particularly, graduate students taking their master's and PhD degrees, working for their degrees, so that their thesis and dissertation can be supported by the research projects. You know, the system that we have, you have a professor who proposes a research, he's also the advisor of MS students and PhD students, so we want to make sure that there is a certain number that they promise to deliver in terms of how many MS and PhDs they can graduate from a research project. And a simple way is to have a simple equivalent. So if we give you 10 million as a research project, you should at least be able to support ano ba doon yung ating indicator? One MS or one PhD, okay? Or two MS and one PhD. The fourth, no, that's already the product, the patent, the publication, the people. The fifth one, of course, is places and partnerships. We lump them together, but basically this is the collaboration or partnership that is generated in doing a research. Whether it is a partnership among research institutions, let us say, well, in one project that we have, and I'm proud to mention this because for a long time, we did not have partnerships with aligned agencies in actual funding of research. And more recently, I was so happy, DPWH funded our research project on the health of bridges and buildings. This is really related to the preparation for earthquakes, okay? And on one hand, the DPWH is funding, okay? The biggest portion, the DOST is funding the part that will be used by PBOX, okay, in the study, and MAHUA is doing the R&D on instrumentation. So this is a partnership, an example of how many partnerships can be generated. And finally, I think although some researchers do not contribute to policies yet, but we count them. Because there are certain researches, for example, in the field of agriculture, okay, in the field of energy, that can lead to policy recommendations. So that will be in the area of project evaluation. We also need studies and policies to determine which sectors to focus on. Okay, so that's why we are partnering with DTI in our inclusive innovation roadmap, because DTI themselves have the statistics, okay, in the industries, in terms of the earnings, in terms of the exports, in terms of the potentials. And this is very useful to us in determining which sectors to focus on in our R&D. Now, finally, we also need policies to align our human resource development program in science and technology to the needs of the researchers and to the needs of our so-called clients, whether the clients are the line agencies or whether these are the business sector or whether these are the local communities. It is important for us to know what are these needs so that our human resource development can also respond better to it. One example, you know, in our scholarship committees, because we have several advisory committees for scholarship. We have an advisory committee for our undergraduate scholarships. There is an advisory committee for our MS and PhD scholarship. Hiwalay pa yung advisory committee sa basic sciences at hiwalay pa yung sa engineering. Of course, in the case of the basic education program, where we support 16 campuses of the Philippine Science High School, we have a board of trustees. And so these are the advisory and policy-making groups on whom we depend for advice. For example, in the advisory committee for the undergraduate scholarships, industry is represented through PCCI, and I think SAP also is represented there. And then, of course, NEDA is there. DTI, if I'm mistaken, is there. DA is there. And CHED is there. And DepEd is there. You know, when we opened the discussion on reviewing the list of priority courses that we have, because we have a list of priority courses, if you apply in a course not in that list, okay, you cannot take the exam, or you cannot be a scholar in a course that's not in the list, okay? And so we also depend on feedback that we have. For example, we held consultations and we got very good inputs from the Department of Labor on how much is the supply for this and how much is demand for this and how much which are the high-paying jobs in, and so forth and so on. Okay, and based on that consultation, okay, our advisory committee approved additional courses which we can include in the list of scholarships. So, for example, we have a very big program on drug discovery and development, and yet pharmacy is not included for in the list of scholarships. So I asked, why is pharmacy not included? And that opened up the discussion on the courses in the health area. Okay? So pharmacy was included, medtech was included, vet med was included, which in the past were not included. Okay? And in some of the new developing areas, a discussion was brought up in the area of industrial design. Because we know industrial design is very important in the innovation ecosystem. And it is not included in our scholarship program. So this was discussed, and I told, ako pa yata yung very conservative in suggesting, let's include the BS industrial design courses. But then, I think there are only two universities offering Bachelor of Science in Industrial Design. I think it's only Mapua and Benil. And the rest are offering BFA major in Industrial Design. Bachelor of Fine Arts, major in Industrial Design. Because the Industrial Design program started at the UP College of Fine Arts. It was followed by the UST College of Fine Arts. And so there are still colleges that programs in industrial design that are under the College of Fine Arts. So I said, okay, let's choose the ones which are labeled BS. But you know, the advisory committee was more open-minded than me. Sabi na, eh kung pare-pareho naman ang curriculum, eh bakit mo pa i-distinguish kung BS industrial design or BFA industrial design? So I think that's the importance of having a committee that can reflect various points of view. Anyway, so these are, well, for example, the policies that we have on how to have better access to our graduate programs. I have to confess that for many decades, the delivering institutions for our MS and PhD are the same. UP, Ateneo, De La Salle, UST, San Carlos, MSU. And, you know, if you come from a particular region, okay, and you have a family, and you want to have an advanced degree in a particular area, it's also difficult to relocate, di ba? For pag PhD ka, at least 3 years. Okay? For MS, around 2 years. So, we thought that consistent with our desire to increase our R&D pool and also to capacitate the other universities which are actually trying very hard to improve, okay? We decided that we will expand our delivering institutions. First, I went to check which universities are offering at least 5 graduate degree programs in science and technology. Out of the blue lang yung 5. if you have 5 programs, we will visit you, okay, and check how it is, okay. And so we came up with a short list, and so we have now a new consortium. Hindi na namin inihalo dun sa mga luma, but this is focused on the regions, and now they are now delivering institutions for our MS and PhD in science, in engineering, including science education and math education. So policies are very important. Anyway, since I have only 1 minute more, this is the time I will talk about IR. we tie it up with our productivity programs for our small and medium enterprises, our setup, small enterprises technology upgrading program. We have already launched the setup 2.0. Okay? And what does that mean? In addition to our focus on individual firms for their technology needs, we are looking now at the sector needs, okay? And this is how we are able to determine which and where and what kind of innovation centers we will set up in the regions. We started with the food innovation centers. We are now looking at the metals and engineering innovation centers. And of course, we are have already implemented our new platform programs that are designed to facilitate the, shall we say, the how do you call it, the roadmap for the SMEs to go towards 4.0. So we have number one, we have now in operation the One Lab Network, where our 22 laboratories have been joined by 4 laboratories of DOH and 8 private laboratories, plus 2 laboratories from Thailand and 1 from Vietnam in the so-called One Lab Network. So you can go anywhere, even if the service is not there, they will accept your sample and you can get the results in the place where you deliver the sample. Our one store was our response to the expansion of the markets for our beneficiaries in the setup program. But we were happy that DTI recommended that their beneficiaries in other programs also join. And so the one store is really an online marketing system. And finally, the one expert, shall we say, website can tell you who are the experts you can consult on any particular area, particularly if you want to upgrade your technology. So there are other things that would help us in this process. Launching of the research and development program on artificial intelligence, our new technology platforms that we have supported. So for example, next Monday will be the inauguration of the Philippine Genome Center, where UP put up the building and DOST put up the needed equipment. And so that is one of the things. The nanotechnology centers that we have supported, both in Diliman and Los Baños and in MSU. And there are a number of other new technology platforms that I think will be very, very useful in our journey towards IR 4.0. Don't forget the role that the Balik scientists can play. I can talk for 3 hours about this, but I think it is a very important piece of legislation that will help us. And finally, let me mention that one of the targets that we have in our setup 2.0, which is supportive of FIR, is our program to lead our SMEs to get ISO certification. And lastly, I think the role of the young innovators that we have is also going to help, because the young innovators are the ones that are very good in terms of digital matters and in terms of AI, and we are taking them in because they can help startup companies that can support the other SMEs. Thank you very much.